So I'm indeed honored to welcome our ma'am. Over to ma'am. Let us enjoy the fruitful learning about our own brethren children with learning disabilities.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning. I'm honored and privileged to be a part of this webinar, the series of webinar which Avinashlingam University is starting. And I just would like to extend my heartfelt gratitude to the Vice Chancellor of the University, Dr. Premavathi Vijayan, Head of the Department of Special Education, Dr. Victoria Naomi, Dean of Special Education, Dr. Geeta, all the management, all the teachers of the department, and also the faculty from the Special Education College. As Dr. Geeta mentioned, I'm only privileged to be here to share my experiences. This day is very special for us, mainly because, as Dr. Geeta said, we are completing 23 years of service today. This is our 23rd birthday. July 18th is our 23rd birthday. And I consider it is a special privilege for me to share my experiences with all of you today. So, what happened in the last 23 years? What are the things we have learned? What are the things we have experienced? That's exactly what I'm going to share with all of you. I know that all of us know the term learning disability. Every one of us is familiar with that word. And we are also very excited with the word inclusive education. And I'm sure that all of you are participating here and listening to this sharing of experiences with all of you are from the different fields of education. And I'm very sure that you all are supporters of inclusive education. We all know learning disability, and many a times what we do is that we think that learning disability is dyslexia. But dyslexia is the only thing which comes under learning disability. There are so many other areas which we teachers overlook, or we do not understand, or we do not know that certain other hidden disabilities are there. So today I would like to give a glance of those areas which are happening, which are very much in our classrooms. And we are at a loss to identify these children and also how to handle these children. So that's where I'm going to give my points on. And I just would like to take you along with this particular, these areas where we are not very well aware of, these hidden disabilities which are in our classrooms. And I'm sure that these explanations or introductions are going to give us a bird's eye view of all what's happening in our classrooms. So let's see, where do we begin? We are at present living in a world of uncertainties. We are all suffering from an unknown fear, and we do not know how we are going to tackle all this. We are all locked down. But the beautiful things which happens during the lockdown is that much learning is happening. Many people are coming with these webinars where we are sharing what we have been doing or what we have been learning. So let's make this opportunity to look into certain hidden disabilities, which are very much in our regular classrooms. So we can say that, okay, I'll begin with something as variety is the spice of life. We all like variety in our lives. We enjoy being different from others. Because those differences give lot of importance. We get lot of appreciation for being different. And the differences make us unique. So let's see how these differences are appreciated, respected, and accepted in general. So the theme of today's program is managing children with learning to think aloud about children with learning disabilities and their issues in learning. As I said, variety is the spice of life. Each and every human being in this world is different. Each and every one of us is unique because of our differences. This uniqueness, this difference is what makes the world beautiful. So I can say that this world is full of all kinds of people with all kinds of minds. And every mind is unique. Every human being is unique. And the brain of every human being is also unique. If there are 300 or a million people in India, we know that there are 300 million differences and differences in the brain. Each brain is wired differently. We have differences which are positive and promising. We have differences which are humiliating and depressing also. We know that different people excel in different areas. Some people, their brain is wired to compose music. For some, to build computers. To some, to design cars and bikes. For some, to draw and paint. For some, to cook. There are yet other brains to diagnose and to treat. There are yet other brains to sing and dance and perform. So every brain is wired differently. Now, do we respect these differences? Is every difference respected by all of us? Yes, we respect the differences which are promising and positive. But what about the differences which are humiliating and depressing? We don't mind as human beings. Human nature is something which we always like to appreciate only the positive. I don't mind my son running a restaurant, but I don't know if I'll be happy to share that my son is a cook there. I don't know how comfortable and how proud I am to say that my son is a carpenter. But I don't mind him having a furniture shop. So what is this differences then? How are we going to treat these differences? There are umpteen number of children who are different, who experience humiliation and depression almost every day of their life. How are we going to respect these children? In reality, we come across a number of children who are experiencing disappointment because they fail themselves, they fail their family, they fail their teachers, and they are not able to perform. Is it only because of dyslexia? No, there are other areas also. But I would like you to know that these children are disappointed with themselves. like he's lazy. Or we say that it is an attitude. And we often make comments like, I know he can do if he really makes up his mind. Is that so? I doubt. Here is a parent who walks into the clinic of a psychiatrist. A mother comes with a son. He failed in the 10th standard, the third or the fourth time, and the mother does not know what to do with him. They come from a very prestigious, socially prestigious family. The mother does not know what to do with him. Mother said he is very much interested in vehicles. She wanted to send him for diploma in automobile engineering. But unless and until he clears the 10th, how is he going to do that? So in the course of the conversation, the mother shares that there in front of their house, there's a huge street. And on the street, many trucks get parked almost every day. And this boy, as he was growing up, used to go and enjoy seeing these trucks. And when these truck drivers open the engine, he'll just go and peep in. He'll just see what's happening. What are the things? What are they doing and all? The mother was proudly sharing that at the age of 18, my son can disassemble the engine of a truck and assemble it in 12 hours' time. That is the kind of mechanical aptitude my son has. But I cannot send him for automobile engineering. So I know that today that man is having his own garage, his own automobile service center, because at that point, the mother was able to identify his skill, accept his skill, and provide, channelize his energy in the right way to give him the right future. He is a man of respect. He is a man of high self-esteem now. Now, how many of our students from our classrooms are going through the same kind of pain and difficulty, and are we aware of it? Let's go to the playground. Let's visualize a scene. Children are playing musical chair, and we usually give musical chair to smaller children. And we all believe that it's such a simple game. All of them, what they have to do is just run around and sit when the bell rings or when they stop clapping or when they stop the music. But do we realize that that particular game demands so many skills? The child should have proper motor skills, especially gross motor development, if he has to run. He should be able to run in circles. And as he is running, he should not bump against anybody or anything. So this child should have the awareness of space. He should have proper visual skills to assess along with the spatial awareness. And he should also have auditory skills. So this simple game demands so many skills. But do we realize that it is so complicated for a child who has a difficulty in any of these areas to manage? They will not be able to play the game. We say that, no, he's not interested in it. But is he really not interested, or he is really suffering somewhere? He's undergoing pain somewhere. That's why he's not able to play that game. Okay, let's go to the classroom. Here's a teacher who is going to tell them that, okay, the first hour we are having an English class. Everybody take your notebooks and your textbooks. Now turn to page number 10. And let's have a new lesson. Here is a child who is fumbling. He does not know to find out from his bag which is his English note and which is his English text. He has got eyes to see, he can read, but why is he struggling? He is not able to find out those things there. And even if he gets it, he is fumbling where to begin. Where is the 10th page? And where is my teacher reading? I'm not able to find out the lines. I'm not able to follow the instructions which she says. So I ask my neighbor, what is the teacher doing? What did she say? And here comes the teacher. Get up. Why are you disturbing others? Is that so? Why is this child not able to find out his books, his organizational skills? Where are they? What is his spatial awareness? What is his awareness, his perceptual skills, his ability to find out things, differentiate things? Okay, let's go and see another scene where the school bus is waiting. All the children are running towards the bus. And some of them are just running and leaving their bags and their lunch box and everything. And the child does not realize that he hasn't carried. Forgetfulness. Is it carelessness? Why is he forgetting these things? Many children say that I forgot to bring my notebook, my homework. Of course, there are children who escape from that. Again, because of a humiliation or a depression, or to avoid a humiliating, depressing scene from the classroom. Okay, when all these things are happening, aren't there differences? How are we going to account for these differences? So a child with specific learning differences, a difference in a specific area. As I said, the wiring of the brain does not allow him to meet the academic needs. He's not legibly. He's not able to spell correctly. He's not able to read quickly. When the teacher says, come on, get up, stand, read. Page number 11, second paragraph, he is fumbling. He does not know where it is. He is not able to work efficiently. And in a sense, the child's abilities and his inabilities are tested throughout the day, challenged throughout the day. And
excuse me. Ma'am, we can't hear any sound.
Are you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Are you able to hear me, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am.
Because I think I got disconnected in between. Okay, ma'am.
Please. Please come back, ma'am.
Sorry, because I don't know who kicked me out. Okay, this is
ma'am. Can you share the presentation again?
Okay, coming back to the scenario which I was discussing.
Ma'am, can you hear? Ma'am? Yeah.
Okay, from where would you like to see the presentation again, ma'am? Is it about the well-being or the... Clear now? No, is the presentation clear now?
Yes, ma'am.
We can see
this, ma'am.
Yes.
Is my presentation clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Hello?
Clear, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Can you see the presentation?
Yes, madam. Go ahead.
Can you see the presentation and hear me?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So coming back to the well-being. We are all very much
again, you're not audible.
Again, ma'am went out.
Some technical glitches.
സൗദി കേൾക്കുമ്പോൾ നിൽക്കലേക്കാണ്.
Okay, so we are now concerned about the learning health of children. Okay. Because learning health is necessary if the child has to experience a well-being. So let's look into this particular part. And as I said, no, the wiring of the brain is different for every single child. And I think the computer is now troubling us now and then, no? I think that would be the best analogy. Our brain is like a computer. We have an input system, a processing system, and an output system. The input to the brain happens through all our sense organs. And the brain is supposed to process it. And we have to give an output of what is being processed orally or in written form, verbally or non-verbally. And some children have difficulty in the input area, or some children have difficulty in the processing area, or some children have difficulty in the output area. This is mainly because our brain is wired differently. So this difference in brain wiring is because of something which we call as the neurodevelopmental system in our brain. Our brains are like toolboxes. And we know that if you open a toolbox, there are umpteen number of small instruments in it, and every instrument is equally important. So every toolbox has different instruments of different sizes, shapes, length. Some are short, some are long, some are thick, some are broad, some are thin also. So just like that, our brain also has number of minute delicate instruments called neurodevelopmental functions. And the health, the learning health of a child or the well-being of the child depends on these neurodevelopmental functions. When a child writes, the brain gives instruction to different muscles to do different aspects of letter formation. We think that writing is so easy. They just have to draw two lines. And if you think about English, we need four kinds of lines. We need a straight line. We need a standing line, a sleeping line, a slanting line, and we need bounces, curves. If we know these many number of lines, we are able to write. So we think that once we teach the child, it is enough. But I just would like you to know that it is the brain which gives the commands. There is one particular muscle which is responsible for making vertical movements. Another one gives the rotary movements, the curves. Another brain gives the another muscle from the brain gives the signal for horizontal movements. And yet another muscle is responsible for holding the pencil properly. If any of the signal from the brain to the concerned muscles is lacking, the child will not be able to write properly. This inability of the brain, or this difficulty of the brain to give the correct instructions at the right time to the right muscle to form a letter, is mainly due to a neurodevelopmental dysfunction that concerns the health, the learning health of the child. Let's look into another example. A child who has difficulty in finding an exact word when they talk. The right word to be used at the right time. Not to associate the sound. I don't know the sound of a letter. I know the letter, but I don't know its sound. The sound and symbol association. When they read, or their ability to understand a complex sentence. These are the examples of neurodevelopmental dysfunction. This is how we try to understand learning disability. Excuse me, somebody has to mute their audio. Somebody's audio is on, please mute it. So the child has, the child does experience difficulty in these areas, and that is why we call it as a dysfunction. Now, if we want to really understand the neurodevelopmental function and the neurodevelopmental dysfunction, we have to understand the 8 neurodevelopmental systems. These 8 neurodevelopmental systems are like 8 inseparable friends. If you experience any one of these areas, the other 7 friends are going to experience it. Any difficulty with one friend or one area or one system definitely affects the other areas or the other system or the other friends. There's a request from me. Somebody's audio is coming on way on my way and I'm not able to talk. Thank you. So we have 8 systems in our neurodevelopmental system. And I just would like to explain each in detail. Let us see how attention is going to help us in learning. This attention control system is like the administrative bureau. The administrative center controls the whole system. Attention control system is the headquarters of all the activities of one's system. Let it be physical, let it be mental, let it be learning. The attention system is very important. We need to pay attention to our body, we need to pay attention to our mind, and we need to pay attention to our learning. So without attention, no activity is going to happen. And attention is something which controls learning and behavior. Attention is something which helps us to distribute the mental energy for each activity. I have to read and I have to write. I have to listen, I have to understand, and then I have to write. So if only there is attention, I'll be able to start an activity on time. Even if it's a 5-minute activity, I should be able to start it at the right time. I should be able to sustain my attention for the next 5 minutes, and I should be able to complete it at the right time. Now think about a child who leaves the home in the morning, listening to all the fights between the father and mother, or any confusion within. A mother who is sick, a grandmother who is sick, a sibling who is sick, and it's a matter of concern for the whole family. A child who is very regular, who has no differences in learning, leaves the home. Throughout the day, the child is going to think about that. It's a simple thing which distracts his attention. Now let's think about another child who leaves the home. And when he's about to leave, his mother tells him that this evening we are going to watch a movie. What's going to happen to his attention? Throughout the day, the child is going to think about the whole process of going back home, changing my dress, having my snacks, and then getting into the car, going to the theater, watching the movie. These are regular things which happen. And when these things happen, definitely the child's attention is affected. One because of a positive end result, one because of a fearful negative outcome. So the child's attention for that day is off. But now what are the problems which we face when the attention control system is affected? Because we know all these words. One is attention deficit hyperactive disorder. One is attention deficit disorder. One is impulsivity. And in an inclusive classroom, we even have a child with autistic spectrum disorder. So all these areas suffer because of lack of attention. An ADHD child, a hyperactive child, is not able to attend to what is happening there. He is not able to sit for more than 5 minutes. He is not able to manipulate his environment in a respectable manner as expected by the teacher. He is not able to sit in one place. He is not able to focus on what the teacher is telling. It is a neurological deficit. Attention deficit disorder, where a child gets switched off now and then. Sometimes it may be because of what we explain in the class. For example, here is a teacher who is explaining the story of Cinderella or a visit to a mall. And the teacher is going to explain different shops in the mall or the scene from Cinderella, how beautifully she is dressed. This child with ADD gets hooked on to that. And her thoughts or his thoughts just wander. In the mall, I saw a toy shop. And in the toy shop, I saw all these toys. So he just gets taken off. He just gets carried away by all these thoughts. That English class must have got over. Next is a maths class. Next is a science class. Till even then, this child will be stuck in that toy shop or in the story of Cinderella. They will not be able to come back because they get carried away by these. And here is another child who is highly impulsive. That is also a kind of hyperactivity, where my thinking is always faster than my writing speed. I'm not able to adjust or correlate or strike a balance between the two. When I see the question paper, if my teacher gives me 3 questions to write, my brain goes so fast, the tape runs so fast that I can see all the 3 answers at one go. I can hear all the 3 answers at one go. So, but when I write, what happens is that all the 3 answers get jumbled or it gets overlapped. And the end result will not make any sense. So when this child comes back home, the mother asks, how did you do the exam? I did it so beautifully. But when the marks come, the child's performance is far, far below the expected level. It is a disability. It is a difficulty. But how do we address this in the classroom? An autistic child or a child who suffers from autistic spectrum disorder. He also is hyperactive. He is not able to focus all the time. He prefers learning mostly when the visual input is there. He may not be able to strike a balance between the visual input and the auditory input. There may be areas which the child is obsessed with certain topics, so he is not interested in the other areas. A regular delivery of the concept will not reach out this child because they are not able to attend to what we give. All these children are in our classroom. This is a learning disability, but it is not dyslexia. We know the terms ADHD, ADD and all, but I don't know how much we give importance to this impulsivity. This impulsivity is seen in reading, in doing their math, so they miss the steps, but they may give you a final answer but the steps won't be there, the process won't be there, the sequence won't be there, and they will not be able to get the equal score an equal mark like a child who is very good. Okay, now to help these kind of difficulties, we need a team to work together. The team consists of parents, the team consists of therapist, occupational therapist, a special educator, and at times a speech therapist also. A therapist's support is absolutely must for the special educator and for the parent to see as how we can handle this child, without which we will not be able to meet the requirements of this child. Okay, the first in the neurodevelopmental system is the attention control system. Now we move on to the next one. It is called the memory system. Often parents say that, in the evening, I teach him everything. He writes the test. He is able to orally give me all the answers. But when he gets up in the morning and I ask him, he is not able to give me any answer. It is not moving from the short-term memory to the long-term memory bank. In some cases, it goes. But when it is not available, when I have to retrieve it or when I want to recall it, it is not available to me. I know that. It's at the tip of my tongue. I know, auntie, but I'm not able to remember. And sometimes children tell us, if you can just give me a clue, if you can just tell me which is the first word. We definitely see children sitting with poems. They need the starting. If somebody could give me the starting word, and he just tell me, or ma'am, just tell me the starting word, or give me a clue. They are suffering because their active working memory is not helping them. So because of that, the child is not able to. So when a child who sits to write, he may be fiddling with his pencils, he may be sharpening his pencils, and when he writes, he will be pressing it so hard because he's trying hard within himself. And the lead keeps breaking. The pencil keeps falling because he's not able to get himself what he wants. Signals are not available from my brain. So he suffers. Now, is active working memory the only thing which prevents a child from reproducing? No. There are other kinds of memory which a child needs. I need to remember what I saw yesterday in the class if I have to do that today. There are children in our classrooms who are not good in reading, who are not able to read also, but they're able to draw the answers and they give to us. Many of them, their photographic memory is very, very high. Their visual memory is very high. They are able to give that. And sometimes even children say, no, ma'am, the questions are not in the correct order. They get that. That much of visual skills are there. But think about a child who does not have the visual memory. I don't remember where it is. I don't remember writing that answer. So to write, we need a visual memory. To reproduce, we need visual memory. Next one is auditory memory. So I'm telling here to my student, don't you remember how we explained that? Don't you remember the words we use for that? In the maths class, the teacher is asking him, which is the vocabulary for addition? Do you remember me telling you, showing the signs or the symbols? No, I don't remember what you said. Next is, there are children who need kinesthetic memory. They can remember only the movements. Without the movements, they will not be able to reproduce that particular concept. There are children who need a tactile memory if they have to get the concept reinforced in them. They have to write and learn. They have to draw lines. They have to color. They have to mark the important points. Without that, the child will not be able to learn it. But we do not know as teachers what is our strong point. Am I a teacher who relies on my visual memory? Then I'll be giving more input in that area. A child who relies on his auditory memory will not be able to benefit from that. If I'm an auditory person, then I may not be giving them enough input in the tactile and the visual area. Then how will he remember that? Another child is here who needs a procedural memory. He lacks it. He does not get the procedure. How to do it, the how of everything is difficult for him. So how is the procedural memory? Without the procedural memory, he will not be able to solve a problem. He will not be able to do an experiment. Even if I know the procedure, I should be able to write it in proper order. I need a sequential memory. I need the sequential memory to learn a poem, to learn the tables, to learn the points. I may not be able to do things on a step-by-step manner. So unless and until my brain allows me to have enough memory, I will not be able to do my lessons. I will not be able to reproduce my lessons. I will not be able to perform better. So I need to find out what exactly my student is suffering from, which is the area the child does not have a strong hold. In what way can I explain to him? Is it because he does not know the procedure, or is it because he does not know the sequence that he is not able to remember that? Moving on to the next area is the language system. When I say language system, it includes two major aspects: the receptive language and the expressive language. I should be able to receive the language. That means I should be able to listen. When I listen, I should be able to hear. I should be able to hear the word. I should be able to differentiate the words. And I should be able to know the meaning of the word. And I should be able to take in that word. Along with the verbal expression, I should be able to understand the non-verbal expressions of the person who delivers. That's very important. A teacher explains a lesson. Of course, the child listens to the verbal input that we give, but he also gives importance to the non-verbal input. Because we know that much of it is through our nonverbal communication. The child's receptive language is both for our verbal and nonverbal input. Similarly, the child should be able to read and write and understand when it comes to expressive language. He should be able to orally express, he should be able to write and express. He should also be able to give us verbally and non-verbally. Now here comes our dyslexia and this learning disability, wherein we say that there are two major areas of learning disability. One is the verbal disability and the other one is the language disorders. So we need to look into those areas. When it comes to verbal disabilities, we have this dyslexia, dysgraphia, and dyscalculia. This means difficulty. So the first one is difficulty with language. Second one is difficulty with writing. And the third one is difficulty with calculations. Often parents come and tell, "My son was very good till second standard in maths, but now he's not able to do maths." Why? he is not able to do maths at this time because there is language involved in it. That is not dyscalculia. That is because of the difficulty with language, he is not able to understand the questions which are given now. And if somebody is going to read and help him to comprehend the question, I'm sure that he will be able to do that maths part better. But a teacher needs to identify why the child is not able to do maths. Is it because he has got a calculation problem or a number problem? Is it dyscalculia or is it because of dyslexia which is affecting his numbers? This graph here is with writing. So when it comes to writing, it has got two areas to look into. One is the process of writing, the handwriting, and then the expressive writing. The language, the use of language, use of vocabulary, and especially semantics and syntax. Meaningful words at the correct places. The sentence structure, how do we do that? So all the three are formed together or come under the main heading verbal disabilities. I have a picture here because I just would like to share my experience with the teachers or whoever is here with me listening to this. We all give a lot of importance to reading. And reading was one of the major area which is going to help us in everything. If we have to learn something, we have to read. Not only reading, we have to read and then write. Whether it is an online class, whether it is a concept from the text, or whether it is something which we have to go to the network and find out, whatever it is, reading is an absolute must. Now we all say that, why can't he read? Okay, we say it is dyslexia. Reading problem is because of dyslexia. Yes, okay. Now how is it happening? I put the pictures here. See, I just would like to compare the brain of a child who is comfortable with reading and a child who is not comfortable with reading. A child who is comfortable with reading, as it is given here, non-impaired reader, his brain has a three-phase connection. Whereas a child with learning difficulty or language difficulty when he reads, it's like a single-phase connection. You know what happens when there is a single-phase connection, when you have to switch on your washing machine, your fridge, your AC. It cannot carry that load and the fuse gets blown off. But if it's a three-phase connection, the load is equally divided. That's exactly what happens to a reader who is suffering with learning disability or reading disability or difficulty with reading. So I have marked, the picture shows three areas which are necessary. One is to articulate the word. And as we are articulating, we are analyzing the sounds which are involved in it, the combination of sounds and how to use it. And when it comes to more difficult words or more complex words, we need to analyze. We look into the parts of speech, we look into the formation of the verb and the morphology of the word. And in the third area, these word form gets integrated into a system, into the context, into the syntax of the sentence. Now, for a child with difficulty in reading, all the three areas are handled by the single center or a single phase connection. And it gets overloaded. So this child finds it difficult to read. Then you may ask me a question, does it mean that the child will never be able to read it? No. Constant practice, it is just like a mechanical input. I would like to compare it to a person who learns to walk with an amputated leg. When he has an artificial leg, he still walks. but under pressure, under stress. Unless and until his body is going to accept it as a part of his system, even then, he always knows that it is an attachment. So the child who has reading problem will always know that I have a difficulty and I have to use the strategies which my teacher has given me. So here, I will have to teach the child the sounds. If it is an auditory word, I'll have to teach the child the sounds and how to use sounds to read the word. So if phonemic awareness is needed, letter sound association is needed, and I have to reinforce that in him. If it is a visual word or a non-phonetic word, I have to use the skills or give the child the skills of word attack. I have to teach the child how to syllabicate, how the words are formed, how to syllabicate and read the words. So unless and until I give practice to this child, the child will not be able to. So as I said, with this kind of language system, we have got one more area which we struggle, that is in language processing and in auditory processing. That is, how do I process what I hear? Now, this child knows to read or this child knows to write, but still the child struggles. Language processing, the ability to look at something, know what it is, differentiate the words, differentiate the sounds, differentiate the meaning, the context of that particular word in a particular context or in a particular sentence, process it and use it. It is a difficult preposition for these children. It is known as an LPD or a language processing disorder. He may be able to talk to you very fluently. He may tell you what exactly he wants and everything. But when you give him something where the language is involved, where he has to go through it, he has to process the context, he has to process the content in it, process the letters and words in it, form phrases and sentences and understand that and reproduce it, is difficult for him. Here is another child. He is not able to process what he hears because he is not able to discriminate the sounds. It is not a hearing problem. He is not able to process what he hears. I give you an example here. I have a student who often complains to me that when we give him dictation, we are confusing him. Because we teachers have a habit of repeating the same word or sentences 2-3 times. Because we feel that there are children who are slow in writing, or some children, if they have missed out one part of it, that they want to write the rest. So for the sake of those children, we keep repeating. But here is one child who tells me, please don't repeat that word. Because every time when I hear that word again and again, it is confusing me. It is just like the sounds are getting overlapped. The sounds get confused within his system. You know how a tape recorder, when it stretches, or sometimes it makes a kind of funny noise. It's something like a wave which is going on within himself. He's not able to process it because he keeps hearing my sound again and again, and my sound is confusing him. So I have an APD problem. So I'm not able to follow your classes. So I need to find out, if you give me things visually, I may be able to process it better. So auditory processing disorder is the only reason why I'm not able to reproduce my answers. I can read, I can write, but I cannot process what I listen to or what I hear in the classroom. The third one is comprehension. There are excellent mechanical readers in our classroom. So we often ask the question, his reading is so good, He can read mechanically, but his comprehension level is much, much below. Many a times we find that there are children who read and write, they can reproduce the answers. And even if we give them a comprehension passage, they are able to give us answers of what, when, where, and who. But when it comes to higher thinking questions like the why and how, they will not be able to give it to us. It's purely a problem of comprehending the language. Many a times when children come for assessment, we know that their reading is good. They may be in a 7th or 8th level or maybe higher than that, but the comprehension level will be much below. So because he's not able to comprehend, he's not able to perform well. So all these come under dyslexia. And as I said in the beginning, we have got this verbal disability of dyslexia, dysgraphia, and dyscalculia. We have got language problems like language processing disorder, auditory processing disorder, and comprehension. And so we come with complaints that he does not listen properly in the class. It's not that he can't. He can read so well. Why can't he understand? There will be disparity between his reading ability and his understanding ability. These children are in a classroom where we are not able to understand. So attention control system is necessary to have memory. If you want to have proper memory, we should have proper language skills. And that language skill should reach out to the child in a proper manner. Unless and until these three things are fine, they will not be able to function. I can say that I have got all the 7 other systems perfectly within me, but I'm not able to attend to in the class. Then every area gets affected. Now let's move on to the 4th area that's called as the spatial ordering system. The spatial ordering system calls for, it's a closed circuit between the eyes and the brain. We have a wiring system in our brain which helps us to differentiate the patterns, the sizes, the shapes. But if there is a child who is not able to differentiate size, who is not able to differentiate the shape, he is not able to identify or discriminate the shapes and sizes, then the child is definitely going to struggle with reading, writing, and numbers. Now, how do we find that? Even in small activities, we can find that this child has got a spatial problem. You give a toy, something to fit together, building blocks. Is my slide visible? Can you see my slide? Somebody please respond.
No, yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. A child who is not able to differentiate the size and shapes of things, how do we find it out? We find the children struggling in different areas. They never close their pen. The cap will be somewhere. The instrument box will be somewhere. The pencil box will be somewhere. It does not have the things in it. He is not able to pack his bag properly. His lunch box is not fitted properly. It's not closed properly. He is not able to put things together, to fit things together. Even if you give him a building block, he will not be able to fit it together. This child often gets confused with left and right. I'm just giving only a few instances so that we will be able to connect it to our classroom. When we give the children stories, when we explain things to them, usually children form mental pictures as we are explaining it. They listen to what we say and they also form pictures and suddenly they ask questions. But a child who has a spatial ordering problem, who is not able to have patterns, sizes, and shapes in their mind, they will not be able to form pictures when we tell them a story. They won't be able to form pictures when they do a sum. They won't be able to find pictures or symbols within their mind if they have to write an answer. These children have difficulty in all these areas. Now please think about a child who is in your classroom. He's able to read and write, but something is not okay with him. Why? The letters, the shapes are different, the sizes are different. We find the children doing that. Suddenly a capital letter pops up. And every time the writing is very irregular. He is not in touch with his own body. You find him very, very clumsy. He does not know his space. So when two people are talking, this child just walks in between. And then we call him and ask him, don't you have manners? Didn't you see both of us standing and talking? No, he's not able to judge the space. He often forgets where his bag is. He often forgets where he was sitting in the classroom. And even if he sits in the classroom, he's not very comfortable sitting. He'll be sitting at the edge of a bench or a table. He'll be moving that. He'll be getting up now and then, which is very distracting for the teacher and for the other students. But we don't realize that this child has a problem. Here is another child who has got a figure-ground relation problem. I suddenly lose my way. I study in the school for this last, I've been studying here for the last 5 years. I know where the restrooms are. But one fine morning, suddenly when I stand, I lose my way. There are children who come back late to the classroom after the recess. We think that we are escaping, but they are struggling within themselves. And anything and everything, when we explain to them, they are not able to form images in their mind because they don't get patterns and shapes, figures in their mind to form that. So the child is struggling. Can you see the PPT? Can all of you see the PPT?
No, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes,
no,
ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
No.
Yes, ma'am.
No, ma'am. Can you see it now?
We could see the PPT, ma'am, presentation.
Okay.
I think few people are not pinning your presentation. That's why they have problem.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. Okay. Now, these children who have difficulty with their own space, how are they going to write on a page with a page with four lines or a page with two lines or a page, an unruled page? Where are they going to start writing? You find children writing from the margin. There are children who disregard the margin. There are children who start from the middle of the page. And we are not able to find out where the next word comes. Lines, space are so irregular, so difficult. And when they write maths, they don't know the place value. Because if I don't know where I am, how am I going to put the letter correctly on a page? If I don't know where I am, how am I going to put the number in the correct place? These children cannot do this carryover and subtraction and multiplication and division and all are difficult for them, not because they are not good in maths, not because they don't know numbers, but mainly because they don't know where each number has to be put. So here is a teacher's responsibility to find out. We can find out easily if you give them these numbers, number dictation, we can understand how they are writing. And suppose you give them a sum like 35 plus 105 plus 6, how will they write the numbers? Will they be able to follow the place value correctly if they have to add three numbers like that? It's easy for us to identify these things. But only thing is that we should take the pains to understand that. If a child is able to do that, not able to do that, sorry, the child definitely has a spatial issue. So all four basic computations are going to be difficult for him. Suddenly he does sums from the left to the right. So one child asked me once, why is it that English has to start from left and maths have to start when I do the computation or the calculation? Why should I start from the right? This child has got a lot of spatial issues. These children cannot do geometry. These children will struggle to learn geography because they cannot do the maps. They cannot understand when you talk about the differences, the location of India, a map, they cannot get it into their system. These children cannot manage time because they don't know how to measure it. It's something which has to come from within. They're not able to do that. They cannot organize their things. Their table will be always in MS. They will be in MS. You won't believe sometimes they even forget to wear the undergarments because they forget suddenly that I didn't wear that. I don't have the books with me. There are children who carry an empty tiffin box to school because I just took one tiffin box and came. Now only I realized that there isn't anything inside. So these children cannot do things, organize things, and organize time, organize their space. Sometimes we say, no, this child is very bumpy. He keeps hitting, he bumps against each other. And often children complain in the classroom, no, he is just trying to lean onto me. He is pushing me. He himself does not know where he is sitting. His legs are hanging. He's scared, when am I going to fall down? Because I don't have a strong ground underneath my feet. Just because of spatial problem, the child will not perform in the classroom. Equal to spatial problem is the sequential system, the sequential ordering system. Sequential ordering system and spatial ordering system are working partners. If I know the space, I can put things in order. If I cannot put things in order, that means I don't have an awareness of the space. They will not be able to do step-by-step procedure. Let it be an experiment, let it be a math problem, let it be arranging the answers or the points in order. They can do that. They cannot do simultaneous activities. I have to read and write. Sometimes we say, no, read and write. Tell loudly and write. No. I can only do one activity at a time. Even that I'm confused. These children find it difficult to follow instructions. Suppose I give an instruction to my student, you please go upstairs, open the cupboard, and just see on the second shelf, I think I have kept my bag. I think I kept it my bag. So the three instructions are there. Go upstairs, open the cupboard, find out my bag, and then bring. If the child is a one-step processor, he can take only one instruction at a time. So these children will go up and come and ask, what did you ask me to do? Or by the time I reached, I forgot what it is. So they cannot process two, three steps of instructions when you give them. But we are very fond of giving long or lengthy instructions. Sometimes we ourselves forget with what we began. But we are relieved that we gave a long set of instructions to the church. Most of the children are at a loss. Suppose I have got everything, and if my attention is not fine, I have all other seven areas perfectly fine. But usually spatial and sequential, if one area is affected, definitely the other area will also be affected. So I'm not able to write, read, do my sums, my spellings are wrong because I forget the size and shape of that particular letter, and I'm at a loss. I remember last year, one of my 10th standard students, after the long vacation, she asked me, and I forgot how to write Q. Q, letter Q, I forgot how to write it. What's happening? Does it mean that she does not know the alphabet? Suddenly somewhere it is lost. Because this child has spatial problems. So suddenly they get stuck. Even they are in the 10th or 12th or whichever class they are. These children have difficulty with managing time. They don't know what exactly time is. They don't understand. Time means what? They cannot measure it. They cannot estimate it. Okay, I have only 5 minutes to do. They don't know what is the difference between 5 minutes and 30 minutes. They cannot estimate the time. 5 minutes means it is only little. 30 minutes means I have got more time. They cannot allocate time. Give me 10 minutes. They don't know what the 10 minutes mean. And they don't even realize how time passes. Suddenly it is lunchtime. They don't know. Sometimes children tell me, no, or tell we teachers, we call them in the evening, we talk to them. Good morning, auntie. Good morning, ma'am. So what time of the day is it? So suddenly we ask certain questions which may be painful for them. These children will find it very difficult to manage money. These children will also find it difficult to understand measurements. Because measurement, money, time are all systems with which we have to know in our body. So unless and until our body is in touch with the environment, with the situation, and I'm able to be sensitive to this, the depth, the width, the length, the thickness, all these things. How does a child come to know about all these things? I think that right the day the child starts crawling, it moves through the different pieces of furniture which are in the room. He hits his head somewhere. He crawls under things. So a child who has a spatial problem definitely has difficulty, must have found it very difficult to go through, or that part of the development may not have happened properly. Only when the child crawls, he understands how much of space is there. So that spatial awareness comes definitely from the brain, from the awareness of the body in relation with the environment. So without that, how is it going to come? So time, money, space, measurements are all necessary for a child. So even if I have reading, writing, everything, I'm fine. If my spatial ordering or my sequential ordering is not fine, I will not be able to perform well in the classroom. The most important, one of the important concerns, I think I can take 10 more minutes. It's the motor system. The motor system is the connection between the brain and the various muscles of the body. The brain has to tell. As I said in the beginning, if a child has to write letter L, there is one muscle which tells him to draw the vertical line, another muscle which tells him to draw the horizontal line, another muscle which helps him to hold the pencil tightly. So unless the connections or the signals are proper to the brain or from the brain to the muscles of the body, the child will not be able to perform that motor activity. When the child does not have proper motor coordination, he always presents himself very clumsy. If only, see, all of us want to do our children do very well in sports, or we all want to become them to be good in swimming, in sports, in playing the guitar, or in playing in any other activity, games, because it's all a matter of prestige for us. But we don't know how many children are good with their motor system in finding out these or getting these instructions when they're from the brain to their muscles at the right time in the right manner. I want my child to write in cursive, but if my muscles are not ready for it, how am I going to write in cursive? Teach my child to write in cursive. But is it mandatory that only cursive writing is accepted in a public exam? What happens if the child writes otherwise? It needs to be legible, readable, and it should be beautiful. I cannot cut using a scissor. I don't know how to use a scissor. I want my son to learn some musical instrument. He does not have the coordination to play a guitar. It is an activity where both his hands have to function. Fingers of the left hand and the right hand need to function. So unless and until I have proper commands from my brain to the concerned muscles, how am I going to do that? So we find parents moving from one instrument to the other, and the child is going through such a big humiliation. We have in motor system, we have gross motor, we have fine motor, and we have got something called as oro motor. In gross motor, we find children finding it difficult to run, jump, hop. They are not able to use their limbs for alternately when they are climbing the stairs. They keep one leg, then they keep their next feet also. Then they need both the feet on the stairs at the same time. Unless and until they balance, they are not able to lift one leg and keep on to the next. They are not able to climb steps like that. Alternate use of limbs is not happening for them. They're not able to understand the left and right directions. They're not able to sit properly in the classroom. They just hold them together. Many a times we find them sitting with their legs up. It is not accepted. It's a matter of disrespect to the teacher if he does not sit properly in the classroom. But if his body is not allowing him to sit properly because of a gross motor issue, what will we do? I have got a fine motor issue. I don't know how to hold my pencil with the three fingers. I don't know to form letters because my grip is not fine. I'm not able to write because I don't have procedural memory. I don't know how to form the letter. I'm not able to write because I don't know how to make vertical movements. I don't know to write because I don't know how to put the curves and the circles. So I'm not able to write easily and quickly. My teacher gets very disturbed. I cannot cut. I cannot draw. I cannot manipulate the small objects. Because of this problem, I'm not able to copy from the board. Copying from the board is one activity. Copying from the book is another activity. A child who has directional problems with a gross motor, a child who has spatial problem, a child who has sequential problem, the child will not be able to copy from the board. He will not be able to even copy from a book which is kept near. So these children often come with a complaint, or teachers often complain that he never completes his note. His book is, his answers are always incomplete. His homework is always incomplete. His classwork note is always incomplete. It is not recklessness. It is not arrogance. It is not an attitude issue. It is an issue with his graphomotor, his spatial, or his sequential order. Please understand these children. These children cannot write your transcription. Handwriting classes are a pain for these children. There are children who suffer from oromotor issues because they are not able to generate a word. Speech generation is not happening because their cheeks are not moving properly, because their jaw is not manipulated properly. Some children, they just, the saliva comes out when they are talking. And we say it's a dirty habit. No, they're not able to manipulate their cheeks. They're not able to swallow that saliva and then talk. They're not able to manipulate the oromotor muscles. Because of the oromotor problem, the child will not be able to answer your questions as soon as he gets up. So and so, please answer. If he's a child who has an automotor issue, he will not be able to give you the answers. You find him struggling. You find him showing faces at you because that is the way he is struggling to answer or utter a word. It is not disrespect. It is not laughing at you. It is not smiling out of arrogance at you. Because I had an instance where once a teacher complained to me that a young boy keeps smiling at her and show faces at her whenever she asks him questions. But that is the way he's trying. He's struggling to get the word out and it's not coming. So we have got three major issues of motor problems: gross motor, fine motor, or graphomotor, and oromotor. And please keep that in mind also. A child who finds it difficult to run and hop and jump and alternate use of his limbs, the child will definitely face difficulty with reading and writing. It is connected to his vestibular and proprioceptive system. We will see that in the afternoon also. Dyspraxia is a highly connected thing where the child is able to think and plan and carry out a motor task. I have to keep the book in a particular way and I have to plan and I have to think, especially when I write. What am I going to write? I have to think. When I think about the answer, I forget the letter. When I think about the beauty of the letter, I forget that word. So thinking about a word, thinking about a phrase, a sentence, and putting them on the paper is a difficult thing for him. Because he has difficulty in muscle control in all the three areas which we said, it is difficult for him to coordinate and do an activity. He has difficulty with language and speech, and this affects his learning. So I think that any difficulty with space, with sequence, or with motor are the areas which is adding to this issue. So the child is not a verbal disability, it is a non-verbal disability. And these things come under non-verbal disability, which we need to be very, very aware of and sensitive to. The next one is the higher order thinking system. That is the summit of our thinking. What are the things a child needs? What are the skills a child needs? A child needs critical thinking when he gives. Why is it like that? How is it like that? Why is it not like that? He should have a creative thinking. He should be able to get out with better ideas. He should be able to solve the problems. He should look at the pros and cons, the why and how of it, and find out solutions for that. He needs to know why the iron sinks and why the paper floats on the water. He needs to know the why of it. It is a thinking ability. He should be able to reason out logically, especially when he gets abstract concepts. The light travels at a speed higher than the speed of sound. Why is it like that? Why is it that we see the lightning and hear the thunder at two different times? Why is it like that? Which one travels faster than the other? We need to have analytical thinking. We need to analyze a sum. We need to analyze the physics issues. Now, if a child has difficulty with the higher order thinking, then it is going to affect his science and maths very, very much. So that's why we say that some children do better in art subjects and some children do better in science subjects or math subjects. So that does not mean that the child is a failure. Every child's brain is wired in such a way that each child's capacity or ability is different. And we have no right to challenge the child based on the ability or an inability. The last one in the neurodevelopmental system is the social thinking system. I know how to attend very well. My attention is very good. My memory is very good. My language is very good. My motor skills are very good. I have good awareness of space. I have good awareness of sequence. I know to think, reason out, find problems, find solutions for my problems. I can do everything. But I am a miserable. I am miserable in the playground. I don't have friends. I don't know how to make friends. I don't know how to keep friends. And many a times I come as a source of nuisance or as a cause of rift in the group. It is mainly because my social skills are not right. So social thinking system illuminates a galaxy of interpersonal strengths and shortcomings. We relate with people. We interact with people. We interact better, you are gratified, you get satisfaction. But when your interaction skills, the social interaction skills are not mature, are not enough, are not appropriate, it becomes a scene of humiliation. So gratification and humiliation are the results of interaction. When your social thinking system is not strong, you end up in humiliation. All these eight factors are highly responsible for the learning differences in the classroom. And all these are the hidden disabilities which we find in a child. The reason for the disabilities. We were discussing the reason for the hidden disabilities in a child. And unless and until we know, realize these areas, we are at a loss to identify why the child behaves like that. We often consider it as an attitude. We often consider it as an issue. But we do not know if it is only that, it is something more than that. Because we do not know why the child behaves like that. Why the child is like that. So this introduction of the eight neurodevelopmental systems is to make my friends, my listeners, to understand your classroom, your students. Everything comes under learning differences, learning issues. As a teacher, we need to be sensitive to all the eight neurodevelopmental systems. We need to ask the question to ourselves, is it an attention problem? Is it a memory issue? Is it a language problem? If it is a language problem, then if it is a verbal disability or a language disorder, or we even have to find out if it is a non-verbal disability. If it is a non-verbal disability, then we have to see if it is a spatial issue, if it is a sequential issue, or is it a motor issue. Then, if the child has to function at a higher level, the child should know the what, when, where, and the how and why of things. Some children have to stop with what, when, where, and who. They cannot give answers for why and how because their higher thinking system is not active. With all these, some children are a pain for the teacher because they always end up with problems, interpersonal problems. Because of the interpersonal problems, their studies get affected. Interpersonal problems can be due to various reasons. Social immaturity, it can be. Emotional immaturity, it can be because I don't know how to handle myself. Or it can be a disturbed home or a disturbed relationships. So that is one thing which we need to keep in mind. So the world is different, the people are different, our brains are wired differently, and let us learn to respect the differences. Because we enjoy being different. Let differences be positive and promising. Let us make the differences which are humiliating and painful, positive and promising. That is the mission of a teacher. And I invite all of you to take it as a challenge and do that for our students. Thank you. Thank you very much. I hope I haven't taken much time. Thank you for the patient listening. Hope you were able to get something which is different from the usual classes.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. It was a wonderful session.
Thank you, ma'am.
It was a wonderful session indeed.
Thank you.
There are questions popping up in the chat box.
Okay.
Due to the paucity of time, let us have a few questions as of now. I request Ayaka Sivagami to unmute and ask. Ayaka Sivagami, you can unmute and ask your question. She has asked a beautiful question, ma'am.
Yeah, please.
Ayaka Sivagami?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, you can ask.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Thank
good
you.
Good afternoon.
My question is, kid who I know is actually super active in almost all activities.
Pardon, I'm not able to. Your voice is breaking.
1 minute, ma'am. Can you hear me, ma'am?
Yes, yes.
Yes. A child I know is super active in almost all activities.
Okay.
But problem is, he doesn't complete his classwork notes. And the mother gets irritated when he doesn't complete his classwork and he's not aware of his homework.
Okay.
But when the mother asks, why do we do like this? He just says, I was just daydreaming about some situation of that happened yesterday or that going to happen now or something like that.
Okay.
So, is he trying to escape? But actually, he's not trying to escape because I have seen him. He's very good in reading, writing, everything. Mm-hmm. But he's not ready to complete his classwork.
Okay. So, we have discussed 8 neurodevelopmental systems, no? Okay. This child may have a difficulty in copying from the board because of the directional issues. Or it is possible that the child is finding a stress in writing because he is not able to follow. See, copying from the board is one activity, copying from the book is another activity. So when he copies, his directions are very much under. He needs to know about his directions. If he's a child who has a perceptual problem, that is when we call it as a visual perceptual problem, that when I see the board, I should be able to differentiate the pictures, the words that we see. and the sentence where exactly it is. So I need to know the directions. I should be able to perceive the word correctly. I should be able to understand in which direction I am writing. So all these areas we need to look into. Is directional skills you have to look into? Is spatial awareness we have to look into? Is visual perceptual skills we have to look into? And also his attention. It may be also because his time, he does not have enough of time management skills. He's not able to manage things within a particular time. So there are umpteen number of reasons which could be leading to this particular area. So as a teacher, and if you are taking care of the child, I think all these areas we need to look into. His spatial awareness, his sequential awareness, his visual perceptual skills, his ability to manage time, and time finish a task in a particular time. We can also look at his organizational skills, how it is in starting a time, sustaining it, and completing it on time. So all these areas we have to look into if he is really good in studies and this is the only area where he is struggling.
Thank you.
Okay. Welcome.
Ma'am, Franklin, you may unmute and ask. Franklin, you may unmute and ask your question.
Hello.
Yes. Good afternoon, sir.
It was a wonderful session.
Yeah.
Actually, many parents, they have doubt that whether when they can put the child in regular. That means, like, simply I'm saying that. What is the benchmark that it shows that the child needs special education or school education?
If the school has the necessary resources, I don't think the child has to come to a special school. If the school campus or the school management is to provide them, has the resources to provide a special educator, an occupational therapist, and the support team to understand him and help him in the day-to-day activities, why should he come to a special school? There's no need for that.
My question, it's not not these things. Like it's parents, they ask, child is normal or not? Okay. I can take her to normal school or special school.
They have so that is something. Okay.
No, our point of view, as a health educator, our point of view, then we can recommend for a regular school and then a special school.
Okay, sir. A child who is in a regular school can go to a special school can go to a regular school when we feel that the child is able to manage himself, take care of himself without much stress. If he can manage and function at an average level, as a person who runs a special center, I'll ask the parent to take him to a regular school, but I will continue to give him a support system. I will also get in touch with the school and see if I can relate with the teacher who is going to handle him, whether I can supplement the areas which the teacher is struggling. I will definitely do that. Or I will just inquire with the school or through the parent whether the school can provide them that kind of an assistance. Will they have a resource room? If the school has a resource room and if they are able and willing to take care of this child, once the child is able to manage his day-to-day activities or his each day in the classroom without much stress, I'll definitely ask the parent to take the child back to a regular school.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Hope I answered your question, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Now, Anand Narayanan, you can unmute and ask the question. Anand Narayanan?
Yeah. Very, very good afternoon, madam. Myself, very, Anand.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, I just wanted to point one thing. If a child is having a dyslexia, and if you want to correct him or her, what is the need? I mean, where is the need? Actually, where do you correct it? Like if you
So the child's difficulty is, okay, the child is dyslexic. Definitely, we have to assess the child to see, is it a problem with reading? Is it a problem with writing? Is it a problem with spelling? So we need to find out. If you take reading, we need to know whether the child knows the sound letter association, which we call it as phonemic awareness, because English has got two kinds of words, both auditory and visual words. So is the child does the child have a phonemic awareness? Is he able to do the phonetic aspect of the language? Or if the words are visual words, which are the areas this child is struggling? Or is it good only in visual words and not in auditory words, or vice versa? So first we have to see which are the areas he is struggling. Then we have to also see which area the child's reading is. Is the mechanical reading good? Is his comprehension reading good? When it is listening, is he able to manage? Or when he reads on his own, he is able to manage? So listening comprehension, visual comprehension, mechanical reading, reading at what level, what are the issues? If he has reading issues, definitely he'll have spelling issues. Then if he has spelling issues, definitely he'll have difficulty with writing. Where exactly the child is, which is the child's comfortable level of performance. Once we are able to identify the child's comfortable level of performance, he may be in fifth standard, but his comfortable level may be only the first standard. Start functioning from there. We have to start at his comfort level and then build up all the skills simultaneously.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, Kaveri? Madam, Kaveri is a parent?
Yeah, please.
She's asking a question.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Voice is breaking. I'm not able to follow you.
Hello, ma'am. Can you hear me, ma'am?
Yes.
Today's session was very useful for parents like us, ma'am. I'm doing weird special education. I'm having a special child also. He's 8 years old, ma'am.
Okay.
He's doing his work. Everything is independent only. According to his studies, he's not performing well, ma'am. I'm also having the same thing. He's also having dyslexia or some learning difficulty. I went to a psychologist, ma'am, but a clinical psychologist. He told he don't have any dyslexia, I think, because his IQ level is up to his mark. If he's seeing the TV channel, means he's able to up to 663. What is the TV channel is performance? He's able to tell 663. QTTV means he's able to tell 690. But I'm going to teach 1 to 50 means he's not able to memorize. He don't want to memorize. He don't want to learn, ma'am. He's under the category of learning difficulty or not, ma'am, because I'm so much of confused.
Okay. One thing I just would like to know that for you to understand is one's intelligence and one's the dyslexic features are two entirely different things.
Okay.
Even if I had a student in my school whose IQ was 120,
okay,
he was highly dyslexic. He was able to give me anything verbally extremely well. He can talk about things at a very higher level, but I couldn't get anything from his paper.
Yes, ma'am.
So intelligence is one factor. Intelligent people can also be dyslexic. That is a totally different. I'm not talking about your child. I'm just made that statement because I got that message that is a perfectly normal intelligence. Will it show signs of dyslexia? Yes, it can show signs of dyslexia. But see, another thing which I would like to clarify is that watching TV and learning are two entirely different areas. One has to do with the activity. You know that the two hemispheres of the brain. Okay? Watching TV, playing with the gadgets, using a cell phone are all mostly the right side brain activity.
Okay.
But when it comes to learning and more of intellectual factors where we have to use the higher thinking system, abstract learning, abstract concepts. Maths is an abstract concept right from the very beginning. Are all matters connected to the left side of the brain?
Okay. So that is also
one of the reasons. That is also an area which we have to look into.
Okay. For him, I'm going to do any assessment, ma'am, for learning.
Definitely,
disability.
You have to do a detailed learning disability assessment with the professional. Pardon?
I'm a Chennai only. Can I go?
You can go to Dr. Jayanthini. She is an authority in this.
Yes, ma'am. I went for him at the age of 2.3, ma'am. That okay. time she told he don't have any issues. He's absolutely okay. That time he told. But yeah. now, after that, after 3, I didn't wait, ma'am.
Okay.
Because after 3 is completely normal, but according to learning, he's not up to the mark. That's when
you need to go back to her, because at the age of 2.5, the issues may not have occurred.
Yes,
okay,
ma'am.
Now that he is in school and he is showing signs of difficulty, you can either go back to her and tell her what it is. Her reports are with you already. You can take it back and show her these reports and what is happening now. Learning disability, it can be a verbal disability, it can be a non-verbal disability, it may be because of visual perceptual deficit, it may be a visual motor deficit, we don't know exactly what it is. Some other reasons which we discussed in any of the neurodevelopmental systems could be an additional factor for not allowing him to enjoy learning now. So please go back to a professional, if to Dr. Jayanthini or to any other people, because Chennai has so many authoritative people, extremely good people who can help you out.
Yes, ma'am. I'm planning to go to Madras Dyslexia Association.
You can definitely go to Madras Dyslexia Association also. There are other places also. If you can call me personally after the session, I can refer you to people who are doing a wonderful job in this area.
Yes,
and
they'll
be able to help you out what exactly the child's difficulty is.
Yes,
now,
ma'am.
I can give you only assumptions.
Yes,
as
ma'am.
I said before.
Yeah. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you. Had a wonderful session, and thank you so much.
Am I audible?
Okay, Syed Hussain, sir, you may ask.
Yes, ma'am. Because sorry for intruding. I'm a visually challenged person, so I cannot chat, type it. So I'm intruding. Sorry for the interruption. My questions are twofold. Like, I have two questions. Before that, I want to thank the university, the department, and the resource person as well. It was an extensive and a very interesting session. My question is this, ma'am. What if the person is blind as well? Yeah, is it going to be easy? But what if the student is a blind person? Identifying him as a dyslexic going to be difficult? Because
I didn't get the first part, sir. Your voice is breaking.
Ma'am, am I audible now?
You are audible, but your voice is breaking now and then.
Okay, ma'am. My question is this, ma'am. I'm a blind and I have a problem with spelling.
Okay.
So, is it going to be related to blindness that my spelling is difficult, I have spelling mistakes because I'm blind or I'm dyslexic? How to find it out, ma'am? So this is one question. My second question is, when it comes for online learning, is it going to be easy for the learning disabled or is it going to be even tougher? So these are the two questions, ma'am.
I'll just answer the second question first, because we are going to discuss the challenges of online classes also in the afternoon. There are very many areas which are limited in the online classes. And online classes is only it's like a first aid that we are doing at present when we are going through this pandemic. Okay. So online classes has its limitations. See, there are two kinds of spellings in English. Okay, as I said, there are visual words and auditory words are there. If you are a person whose auditory skills are good and if your phonetic awareness is good, your auditory words, spelling will definitely be good. Visual words, where we look at the words and see, there you may be struggling. So I need to know whether you are struggling with the phonetic words or the non-phonetic words, with the visual words or with the auditory words. Okay, if it is with the visual words, it can be due to the condition which you have, whereas otherwise, we definitely need to look into whether the basic input which you got as a small child was enough or not. Excuse me, sir. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, thank you.
Did yes, I answer ma'am. Your question, sir?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. That would be. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Now, Kritika. Kritika Sibanyanam.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
My child near here, he is 10 years old now.
Yeah.
He was six years and 7 years. He put all the mathematics easily and he was brilliant on the time. But okay. Now, he is keeping in only about the mathematics ones, but he is good in reading, writing, everything. But now he is simply escaping from the math skills. If we ask you to do any mathematics, or he is simply, I know, auntie, I know this, I will not do now. Okay. Like that, he is simply escaping. And if we compelled him to do, he is doing wrongly. But he was good at when he was 6 year and 7 year old. He put all the sums very nicely and he was brilliant in maths too. But now he is simply sleeping and doing something else. What we can suggest him or his father to do?
Let me ask you a question. How good is his understanding the language?
He is good in languages, ma'am. He is studying
in comprehending language.
Yes, ma'am. He is also
good. He is doing comprehension well.
No, ma'am. He's only having problem in the multiplication sums. He is not remembering. He is not putting answers correctly like that. If we
he is able to do addition and subtraction well.
Yes, ma'am. Addition and subtraction he is doing good, but the multiplication he is having the trouble.
Okay. Then just as we say that when I give rice and dal to my child, it is fine. But when I give the child non-veg and rice, it doesn't digest. Okay. The manner in which the multiplication concept has gone into him may not be the proper way. He may not have understood the concept in the right way. That should be the reason why he is escaping from multiplication alone. If it is a difficulty in other areas, I would have asked you to look into other areas. But if this is the only concept, then he has to be taught in a way that he understands in the manner in which it should be delivered to him.
Okay, ma'am. Can you give any remedial for that? To remember the multiplication?
You can ask the teacher. See, in the afternoon, we are going to see what are the styles a child learn, with which a child learn, and what are the styles a teacher uses to teach a child. We have to use, if he needs visual clues, we have to give him visual clues. If we have to give him more reinforcement of the symbols, the place value, how it has to be placed, how the process goes, from step number one to step two, what is the procedure involved in it? If things are delivered to him in the manner in which he understands, provided he is good in all other areas, in other concepts, then we can definitely bring him up.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, Arshin Rafiq.
Hello, ma'am.
Arshin Rafiq.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Ma'am, I have a question to you.
Yes.
How to control self-abusive behavior in children with autism?
They're self-abusive or self-destructive?
Self-harming.
Okay, there are reasons could be many. It definitely needs the help of a therapist in handling situations like this. In the case of an autistic child, we definitely need the support of a therapist. Okay.
I'm very adamant also.
Okay, that is a part. See, why does he behave like that? One thing is that he is not able to communicate his needs just like us. He is not able to word his frustration. He does not able to give an expression to what he goes through at each time of the day. He is not able to express his needs properly. He is growing up. Changes are happening in his body. He is not able to understand what is going on within. And if it is now the pandemic situation, he does not understand why he is locked up within the four walls, what is happening around. He is restricted. So that it can be an external factor. It can be an internal factor which is disturbing him from him. But in either case, we definitely need the help of a therapist.
Okay.
And you also need the professional help from a child psychiatrist or a child psychologist. Okay. He may need the modification, he may need relaxation therapy, and he may need the family's larger support.
She is 7 years old, ma'am, but she is not able to talk, poor eye contact.
Mm. Yeah, those are all symptoms of autistic spectrum disorder. There are schools which are specially catering to the needs of a child. So 7 years, it's the right time. I mean, you should start early, but even at the age of 7, you can definitely get help from a special educator and an occupational therapist to handle this and to help the child to come up.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Welcome.
Ma'am, thank you, ma'am.
Hello, ma'am.
There's a lot of questions popping up. I think we are running out of time. We'll just take Soundarya's question and one more question and finish off the session.
If you
can also keep posting the questions.
Please, you can ask the questions.
Ma'am, to include
you can take my number and ask me the questions, or you can send these questions as email to me, because my email ID I'll give you at the end. Please do that. I will be only happy to answer your questions.
Yeah, ma'am, did not even have a cup of coffee and continuously speaking.
That's okay.
Yeah, Soundarya.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, I have a doubt about one boy, ma'am. He's a 14 years child.
Mm-hmm.
And he's having a problem like a learning disability, little bit. But we were not confirmed because now only we watching closely. Because he is not having a father, mother. He take care of child of grandparents.
Mm.
So we didn't take care also. Now only we watching up. He didn't listen anything.
Mm.
And little bit it will be normal.
Mm.
Because nowadays it will be COVID-19. We didn't go to hospital also.
Mm.
So, but grandparents are telling like 4 years they are watching. They are watched with some symptoms like learning disabilities. Like ADHD, hyperactive.
Mm.
So, currently, we didn't get any idea about that child.
Mm.
But now it is 14 years. Lastly, we contacted some doctor psychologist.
Mm.
He told me, like, an 8-year child, what are all they doing, like he doing now.
Mm.
So, what is the difference? We didn't understand even now also.
The child needs a proper assessment, ma'am. From a professional, okay?
Okay, ma'am.
We need to look into the child's IQ. We need to look into the child's
IQ level. It's already taken 80, ma'am. Below 90. Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah. So we know that it is a mild borderline thing is, but we cannot just take it like that. Because many times in the IQ report, if you ask me personally, I always keep it aside unless and until I deal with the learning issues. Okay, because sometimes the IQ assessment, the child may not be able to do properly because of his difficulty in handling the language or in following instruction, or it could be because of any of these other issues which we discussed. Okay, so this child has to undergo a detailed learning disability assessment to find out what exactly the areas of strength and the areas of difficulty. And then only we will be able to come to a conclusion. And we also have to look into the fact that he's now 14 years. He's a growing up child. He's an adolescent boy. We don't know what emotional trauma he is going through. That is also very, very important to look into. So a proper psychiatric or a clinical psychologist has to evaluate him and find out the reasons. Only with
ma'am,
that.
Can you suggest? Yeah, ma'am. Can you suggest any psychologist in Chennai, ma'am?
There are umpteen number of psychologists. Can call me personally, I'll give you which part of Chennai you are staying. Accordingly, I'll give you a number.
Yeah, yes, ma'am. Not Chennai, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. Please. I will contact you, ma'am.
Please.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much,
ma'am.
Yes.
Last question, ma'am, from Mahalakshmi.
Okay.
Dr. Mahalakshmi, you may unmute and ask your question. Dr. Mahalakshmi? Ma'am, she is our librarian. She has posted a question related to inclusion. She is bothered how the children will be humiliated by discrimination in inclusion. So a lot of questions are coming up regarding inclusion. Why and how inclusion you may include, ma'am. Either you may include in the afternoon presentation.
No, I will just mention that in the afternoon when I discuss.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. One more question from our HOD education. She has asked tips to improve memory.
Okay.
This also
okay.
You may
include. Yeah, ma'am. I think I'm dealing with it in the afternoon.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Excuse me, ma'am. One more question. Ma'am, may I ask question?
Yeah, please.
Ma'am, my cousin daughter, she is visually challenged, ma'am. Mm. But she is studying very well. She has a sorting trouble problem, ma'am. Because of this problem, she totally disturbed.
Mm.
But she learned very well compared to general student.
Okay.
What can we do, ma'am?
See, if she is... is able to develop her confidence, believe in herself, believe in her positives, she will be able to manage it. But somebody has to help her to look into herself, identify her positives, accept herself as somebody good, and start liking her, start respecting her, start regarding her. Definitely there will be a change in her attitude to herself. If there is a change in the attitude to herself, she will definitely be able to. Pardon? She will definitely be able to gain the confidence to meet the world outside. If she gains the confidence to meet the world outside, this difficulty will naturally get vanished. Hello? Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Because when she is a physically challenged child, definitely there'll be that kind of a discomfort within herself. Now, will I be accepted by